He wasn't particularly fast, but he had a knack for busting it up the middle. For 3 years, he punted, he ran back both punts and kickoffs, played stellar defense, and shined in an era that featured great all-purpose halfbacks. A talented quarterback knew how to get him the ball, and a legendary coach said this about what two-way Johnny meant to his team.
He could tackle okay, he could block okay, he could run okay, he could catch the pass okay, he could punt okay. I wasn't great in any of these, but I could do it. I could do all of them.
In 1953, believe it or not, a loaf of bread cost only 16 cents. And Marlon Brando won his first Academy Award for On the Waterfront. With the election of Ike, the Korean War ended.
It took 2 years and 17 days, possibly the longest armistice negotiations in history. But 575 meetings at last bear fruit. Panmunjom becomes a place secure in history's annals.
Dateline Moscow.
Joseph Stalin of Russia died.
Joseph Stalin at the time of his death in 1953 was truly one of the most powerful and dangerous men in the world. He had elevated Russia to a height from which she could now dictate whether or not the people of the earth could continue to live quietly in peace.
And Queen Elizabeth of England was crowned.
Having thus been officially crowned, Elizabeth II Regina, she sat regally upon the throne to receive her husband's vow of fealty.
And in that year, one of the top shows on television was I Love Lucy. And also in 1953, Johnny Lattner of Notre Dame became the 19th winner of the Heisman Trophy. You won the Heisman Trophy, you went to New York for the banquet. You had a great time, but from what I understand, your mother had a better time.
My mother may enjoy the heck out of it. The first day there, they said, you know, we have a limousine, you know, whatever you want to do, Miss Lattner, whatever you want to see. She says, I want to see the big ships. So they took her down to see the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth. They took us out on town. They took Tut Shores, the Stork Club, Club 21, Leonie's. We ended up in the cabana. Now, my mother liked martinis. She really did. And she was a great, she could hang in there with the best of them. It's 2 in the morning, and the guy, the tour director said, you know, tomorrow's going to be rough, Jan. You know, you're going to see that you're going to have all the press are going to be there tomorrow and the whole bit. I said, well, talk to my mother. The guy went up there and said, you know, Miss Lattner, tomorrow's going to be a rough day. She said, yeah. She said, it will be. She said, well, instead of a martini, I'll have a Miller's. So we stayed about 3 in the morning watching the girls.
What was the final decision to go to Notre Dame?
Well, actually, I think my dad really wanted me to go to Michigan because I was in Michigan in those days. They had Benny Usaban, they had the single wing, and my dad thought Michigan was a great school. But he said, you know, he left it up to me. And I, you know, there was a lot of Notre Dame fans on the west side of Chicago. And, you know, one of the reasons I went to Notre Dame, because everybody told me that up to that time, don't go to ND because you'll just be a number down there. Jan, you're not that fast, you're not that big. You'll never make the team, you'll just be a number. So I said, well, if that's the case, if I'm going to prove anything to myself, I'm going to have to go there to prove that I can play with the best.
You played with some great players at Notre Dame. I'm going to mention them. We call them. Ralph Guillaume, the quarterback.
Googs was a great split-tee quarterback, great passer, could throw the short pass, excellent. Great option quarterback. He could run as good as any of them, as far as I was concerned. And one thing we did do with the split tee, which was strictly a running offense, we did a lot of throwing. And Coach Leahy put in a lot of drop-back passes, and not necessarily play-action passes. They were drop-back passes. And Googs had a great, great percentage.
The fullback, Neil Warden.
Could have been a Heisman Award winner. Neil Warden, great blocker. He never missed a block. You know, he'd go out those outside linebackers, and it was fun to run behind him. And we knew each other's moves. I can remember a couple of times against Georgia Tech, I was getting tackled, and I'd throw the ball back over my shoulder. Just throw it over my shoulder. There would be Neil. He would make another 10 or 15 yards with the carry. And we had a great unit. We knew each other's moves. We played 3 years together, Joe Heap, Guillaume, Neil, and myself. And it was a great backfield.
classic stories about a legendary coach after this.
You were called two-way Johnny at Notre Dame. How?
Well, I actually, you know, I played both ways my sophomore year. I played the last three games of my sophomore year, I averaged about 50 minutes. And that was the year we were 7-2-1. I was only a sophomore. And I actually started out playing defensive football at Notre Dame. I was not the first string halfback offensively. Like Leahy used to say, he could tackle okay, he could block okay, he could run okay, he could catch the pass okay, he could punt okay. I wasn't great in any of these, but I could do it. I could do all of them. And that day you played, you know, Leahy always wanted you to play 101% on each and every play. Well, you just possibly couldn't do it. I mean, we opened up with Oklahoma. It was 103 on the field, and I played, I think, over 50 minutes. We only played 19 guys.
There were 8,000 people who imitated Leahy, but all the players say you were the master. You fumbled four or five times against Purdue. Tell me about the meeting.
Monday afternoon. Right after lunch, Leahy would assemble all his boys at the law auditorium, and he would go over all the mistakes that were committed the previous Saturday. And this particular Monday, here's where some of the words he said about this particular, oh my goodness gracious, last Saturday against the enemy lads, there was a young man who disgraced his teammates. He disgraced the coaching staff here at Notre Dame by his five fumbles. And he went on and he says, I have told this lad time and time again, as he grasped the pigskin from the quarterback, I want him to hold on to the ball, and as he gets into the end zone, we expect our halfbacks to have the ball under their arms, not back on the five-yard line. And he went on to illustrate how the halfback should get the ball. He wouldn't even let me be in the illustration on the stage, right there in the law auditorium, step by step by step, how the quarterback should give the ball to the halfback and how the halfback goes through the line. He did that for a half hour. Finally, after this illustration and this demonstration by the other teammates, he dismissed this. And as I got to the end of the room, he says, oh, Mr. Lattner, I'd like to have a little chat with you if you wouldn't mind. So I said, sure, coach. You know, I ran back. And he said, well, what in the world ever happened to you last Saturday, John? Why a boy of your caliber? Why would he fumble five times? I said, coach, I really don't know. I must have got hit. I really don't have any reason for it. He says, I was wondering, do you have any type of girl problems back in Chicago that would cause you to fumble five times? I said, no, coach, I have no girl problems. He says, I understand, John. In Chicago, your dad and you used to go to one of the horse races at Hawthorne. Did you ever bet on a horse? I said, sure, I did, when I had the money, coach. He says, did you have any money bet on with the bookies back in Chicago? What was my problem? You know, did I have a girl problem? Did I have money problem? I didn't have any money. But that's the type of coach he was. He wanted to find out why I would fumble five times.
1953, the year Frank Leahy said, we'd be lucky to make a first down. Notre Dame almost won the national title. Yeah. In October, Georgia Tech comes to South Bend with a perfect record in one of the big games of the year. And something happened at halftime that you're going to remember the rest of your life.
We had Georgia Tech going pretty good, and they scored a touchdown to tie us 14-14 at half over Tom McHugh's head. So when we went into the locker room, all of a sudden, Gene Paskett starts running back and forth to where the coaches were, and also Father Hesburgh goes back. And then all of a sudden, Dan Pinza goes back, who was our captain. And he comes back, and Dan Pinza, a very nice guy, comes back, he says, the coach is dying. And it's funny, I was sitting next to my good buddy Bobby Regali. Now, his dad played for Rockne back in 1924 and used to hear all the Rockne stories, the halftime stories of how Rock would get the team up. So as Dan Pinza comes back, he says, the coach is dying. Bobby Regali gives me the elbow. He says, he's pulling a Rockne. Don't believe him. He's pulling a Rockne to get us up for the second half. I started laughing, and everybody looked at me, and I had to shy off. But he had the... what do they call it, pancreatitis attack, which kind of resembles a heart attack.
He had the last rites given to
him. Yes, he did. Yeah, he did. You know what happened then? The following week, he was at St. Joe's Hospital, and he had a closed circuit television set up to watch our practice sessions the whole week from his hospital bed. That's how perfected he was.
Would Frank Leahy win today?
I think he would have a hard time coaching these kids today because he was such a taskmaster. I don't think those kids would go along with his type of coaching. I really don't think so.
Growing up happy despite the depression. After this.
High school player, Fenwick High in Chicago. You were an end as a sophomore?
Sophomore and junior.
And you became only a running back your senior year?
Well, Tony Laws, who was our high school coach, who was a great coach and a coach very similar to Leahy, was a fundamentalist. And because I was an end and sometimes the halfbacks would get hurt on the single wing, he would try me out as a halfback from time to time. And during my junior year, yes, I played some halfback. And in my senior year, I was the captain, and he made me the left halfback. We used the old Notre Dame box, and I was a tailback, and I carried the ball a lot, and we had a great team, and we won 11 games, and we lost one game. So we had a great season my senior year at Fenwick.
What was it like growing up in Chicago in the 40s?
Well, it was tough. I grew up in a neighborhood that was a lot of apartment buildings. In fact, I lived in an apartment building. We had a kitchen, a dining room, and a living room. We had the Murphy pull-down bed. And my mother, my dad, my sister, my brother, myself lived in that apartment with a washroom. And in the apartment building, it had 105 flats, and I bet you we had 60 kids my age in that apartment building. So you learned fast. Anybody that wanted to get some pride in themselves and wanted to get their morale up, they would take me on as a target. And I would come up crying all the time to my dad. You know, geez, my mom, they're beating me up again, they're beating me up. And this went on and on for a long time until one day my dad said to me, he said, listen, they're going to beat you up. You better start to learn how to react to their beating because you're going to get beat up anyways. And I did. And all of a sudden I was beating up on kids and they weren't coming after me like they used to. And then I got into the sports, and I became a gym rat. Our grammar school where I went to had an enclosed gym. I used to be over there from the time we got out of school until 6, 7 o'clock at night, and I learned how to play basketball. And from there, I learned how to play football, and it was great.
The pecking order at home when you were growing up, where did you fall?
Well, I was a youngster. I was a young kid in the family. I was the kid that my brother didn't go to college, my sister didn't go to college. They said, Jan, you're going to go to college. And probably the only way I could have gone to college is through a scholarship. We just didn't have a lot of money around. I would have probably gone to work.
But everybody in the neighborhood was kind of in the same boat, weren't they?
Oh, sure. Yeah. God, during the Depression, you know, my dad didn't pay our rent for 2 years. But you know what he did? He would paint apartments for the building. He would sand floors for the building. He was a carpenter. He was a jack of all trades. That's how we stayed in the building for 2 years without paying rent.
Your dad's German?
Yes.
Your mother was Irish.
Yes.
Tell me about your mother.
Well, my mother was a sweet lady. She could control my dad, my dad could control them, and they had some good fights. You know, the Irish and the Germans, that's a good mixture, but they had some great fights, and they understood each other, and they loved each other, and they had a couple beers together, and they would talk over things together, and I loved them. They gave me a great beginning. My mom and dad, I couldn't have asked for a finer parents.
Your dad had two jobs.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. You know, he worked at American Color Type as a maintenance man on those big Gauss presses, and they used to do the Life magazine four color jobs. And then he was on the midnight shift, 12 to 8. He'd come home in the morning, and he'd have a couple little shots, and then he used to go out and repair washing machines and vacuum cleaners on his own. In fact, he started on a bicycle with his tool chest on the bike, and he made enough money to buy a secondhand car. And that's how he used to get his other money, you know, and then hide it from my mother, because my mother used to like to get that little extra money, but he used to hide it there, and she found it all the time. great guy. He really was a very, very instrumental in my makeup. He was the guy that gave me the get up and go and the desire to really want to, you know, do things with athletics.
You're at Notre Dame. It's 1950. Your dad is sick.
Yeah.
What was it like?
Well, you know, at the time he was operated my freshman year in October. And I didn't know about the operation. A friend of mine came to the game and said, your dad was operated on today for ulcers. You know, they wouldn't even tell me he had cancer. You know, they didn't want to worry me. And I said, oh, so after the game, I went home and I went and saw him. And they didn't tell me he had cancer until January 1st. That's when I found out my dad was dying.
Shortly before your dad died, you and a few teammates visited him. Tell me about that.
Well, it was during the Easter break. And we went over to St. Anne's Hospital where he was. And Johnny Pettibone was there, and Johnny Mazur, who was the quarterback, and Billy Baird, who, these are all seniors now, going to be seniors. And when they talked to my dad, Johnny Mazur said, listen, Mr. Lattner, the first opportunity that John gets on offense to get in the game, we're going to have him score a touchdown. And you know what? It did happen to me. I started at Notre Dame as a defensive back, and we're playing Indiana. And we're beating Indiana pretty good, so Leahy put me in the backfield, and it was about the 5-yard line. And I got the ball. Well, you should have seen the hole I hit. I mean, I hit a hole that a Mack truck could have gone through, and I did score a touchdown the first time I got the ball.
Golden memories at the Golden Dome after this.
What is it like, pressure-wise, to play for Notre Dame?
Well, the pressure is tradition at Notre Dame. I mean, the pressure is trying to do a better job than the teams before you did. That is the pressure. And the Leahy would always use that type of format to arouse you, to get you going all the time, to try to live with the tradition of Notre Dame. And tradition of Notre Dame is a great thing, the Rockne tradition, the winning tradition, the come-from-behind tradition. That's the pressure of Notre Dame.
You also had pressure grade-wise.
When I got my diploma, I had my C average, in it, which we had to maintain a C average down at Notre Dame to be eligible. And then to get a diploma, I got this C average, and I was so happy. It was a struggle, but I made it.
John, you played in a lot of memorable games. What is the most memorable one?
Actually, you know, it was my high school game in 1948, my junior year, 71,000 people, the championship for the city of Chicago. We played Lynn Bloom High School for 71,000 people. I was really scared. I was petrified. I was excited. Unfortunately, we didn't win the game, but it was a great thrill, not only for myself, but for my dad and my mother, to be at the game, 71,000, see their little son, Johnny, on the football field in front of all those people.
Most memorable game at Notre Dame.
I think it was the Oklahoma game, 1952, against Billy Vessels. I had some good times there and bad times. I fumbled the ball once on the 1-yard line, going in to score. We didn't score. But the next series of plays, I intercepted a pass against Buddy Leak and ran it back to the 8-yard line. And then we did score, and we tied him up at 21-21. And then I made a nice run right before when we went in for the winning touchdown. I made about an 18-yard run, which was my highlight of that day. And it was a tough game. But it was a fun game.
What movies in your lifetime did you like?
Now, this is going to sound corny, you know, but the greatest movie that inspired me was Knut Rockne, All-American. I saw it down at Notre Dame, and I thought it was great. And it sounds corny, but I thought it was great. And I saw Ronald Reagan as the Gipper, and I saw Pat O'Brien as Rockne, and I saw the spirit. I felt the spirit. I felt the vibration. I was a freshman there, and that tradition was just right on the screen, right in front of me.
You had never seen the movie before?
Never saw it before in my life. And I saw it for the first time. And I broke out, you know, sounds silly, but I did break out in a sweat. And I couldn't wait till the next day to get my freshman green jersey on to go and scrimmage the varsity.
Life after football, after this.
Okay, this is our oldest son's wedding, our first child to be married.
John and Peggy Lattner live today in the same town where they were both born, Oak Park, Illinois, just west of Chicago. Married over 35 years, they got a lot to be proud of, especially how they raised their 8 children.
There's Gretchen, the baby.
Your wife, Peggy, how did you meet her?
Well, we met in high school. She went to Trinity High School and I went to Funk right here in Oak Park. And a good buddy of mine who was at Mel's was dating a good friend of hers. And I was around her one day and she said, I'd like to date this guy. So on my 16th birthday, they had a surprise party and I was her surprise, or she was my surprise. And I wanted to meet her too. That's how we met.
You've been married all these years and you have so many people who cannot stay together when they get married. How did you do it?
Well, I married a wonderful lady. And I was in the restaurant business for 11 years. And that's when we were having these kids. These little tots were really growing up. And Peggy, hung in there with me. And it was a rough, I was down working all the time.
8 children.
Yeah.
How many grandchildren so far?
So far, well, we just had one the other night. This is our 8th grandchild. And our 9th. We're expecting 2 more by the end of the year. So our family is growing, and it's really nice. Our kids live right around here in Oak Park. Some live in Oak Park, some live in Hinsdale, some live in Riverside, but they're all around. We have a lot of good times together.
You graduated from Notre Dame and you were drafted by the Pittsburgh Steelers. What was it like playing pro football?
Well, Beano was a great experience, and I was drafted number one by the Steelers, and I was very happy to be drafted number one. I got a bonus of $3,500 for signing, which was more money than my dad ever saw in his life. And I had a fairly decent year. I scored 6 touchdowns. I played some offense, I played some defense. We won 5 games, and actually at one time we were 4-1. We were leading the league, and the fans in Pittsburgh were going wild. They thought this was going to be their year.
You went in the Air Force. You hurt your knee.
Yeah, I tried to go back with the Steelers in 57 after I got out, and I stayed with them for 6 exhibition games, and my knee just got worse. It just swelled up on me. In fact, I used to tape my own knee because I used to use the old inner tubes, and I'd stretch an inner tube across to kind of give my knee extra strength. But after we played our last exhibition game, I went up to Buddy Parker. I said, Coach, I don't think I can help your team out. And I saw Mr. Rooney, and Mr. Rooney says, we'd like to have you stay around, Jen. We really want you around. I said, well, I don't see any future in here, Mr. Rooney. I think I better get on with my life. And I left Buffalo, New York, and drove my car back to Chicago and started working.
1958, you coached high school football, Wisconsin.
I was their first coach. It was a brand new Catholic high school, St. Joseph's High School. And I had a lot of fun with those kids, scrimmaging against them. I used to run punts back, and they used to love to try to kill me. I mean, it was a lot of fun with the high school kids. But then the next 2 years, I went to the University of Denver. I coached in the backfield for the University of Denver out in Denver, Colorado. And it was fine out there. We only won 5 games, but they didn't fire us. They just gave up football. So, and I gave up coaching. I had to go to work other than coaching, and I started selling business forms in the printing business, which I am in today.
Was it tough?
It was tough. Oh, yeah. I worked only on commissions, and in printing, it takes a long time to build up a repertoire of customers. So it was a tough period of my life, and I did a good job out there, and I left there and came to Chicago and was selling printing in Chicago for my brother-in-law, and then went in the restaurant business because I wanted to own my own business. And I did have the restaurant down on Madison Street in Clark, downtown Chicago, for 5.5 years. Had a great restaurant, did a great job. Unfortunately, we had a terrible fire and went over to another restaurant, a bigger and better restaurant, bigger and better expenses. And we stayed there 5.5 years, and I finally walked away. My kids were growing up, and I said, hey, I'm paying too much attention to the restaurant. I have to start working on my kids and being a family man. So I got back into the printing business.
John Lattner, Fenwick High, Heisman Trophy winner, Notre Dame, married, father of 8 kids, probably about 40 grandchildren before it's over. What would you like to have as your epitaph?
You know what? My epitaph would be I hung around with the best. I was married to a great lady, and I hope my kids will have a married life that I had.